Praise God. Things are happening.
Amen.
Are you in the happening?
Amen.
This is the night the Lord has made, and we will rejoice because we have a
choice.
I love it. Isn't it wonderful that you have a choice to rejoice? Matthew 24. Thank you, my Lord. We ask that you illuminate your word and bring revelation, impartation. As you prepare us for mighty, mighty move in Jesus' name. It's an awesome, awesome time to be alive. Awesome. We are in perilous times, but we are in glorious times. And things are about to get really cool. In Matthew 24. I want to lay the Word of God is so powerful. It's past, present, and future. It's three-dimensional. And without the Holy Spirit's interpretation, you won't understand it. Amen?
Amen.
That's why the Holy Spirit's the one that interprets. And Matthew 24 and verse 3, would you read it with me, please? Now, as Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us when these things will be and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age. In other words, they were asked, Jesus was expressing certain things to him, to them. And they asked him, Lord, you know, we understand some of the things that you're saying, not all of it. But we know that there's an age that's going to come to an end. But they were talking about the age of grace. The age of grace. When will the age of grace come to an end? Now, the age of grace is a representation, grace meaning God's plan. Amen? You know, so many people keep going, well, I'm saved under grace. Well, let me tell you what grace is. It's cooperating with God's plan. Amen. So grace is God's plan. And the purpose of his plan is so that you and I escape the deception of the devil, amen, in his plan, so we don't get caught up in it, snared or taken captive, and so we can escape the wrath of God. Because if you can't escape the plan of the enemy and be captive, you are going to fall under the wrath of God. Amen. Does everybody get it? So they were asking Jesus, when will this be? When will this end of this age come? In other words, and when will your coming be? So there's two things involved. When is the end of the age and when is your coming? Does everybody understand this? Okay, let's go a little further. Hallelujah. And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name saying I'm a Christian or I am the Christ and will deceive what? Many. And you will hear wars and rumors of wars. Is that happening now? See that you are not troubled, for these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and this means ethnic group. In other words, there'll be more racism, there'll be more Semitism, anti-Semitism, more hatred towards one another. And kingdom against kingdom, and there'll be what? Famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in various places. Is this happening now? Amen. It's tremendously happening. Even though you don't see it being reported by fake news, it is happening if you do the research. It is tremendous. Remember, majority of the news media is under Satan's rule. Amen. So they're going to prevent things from you knowing. They don't tell you about all the persecutions of Christians being killed and everything else that's happening right now. Okay, verse 8. He said, and these are the beginnings of sorrows. So we have the beginning of sorrows, and there'll be tribulation and then great tribulation. It says, then they will deliver you up to tribulation, and they will kill you. And you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. Let me tell you, that is happening now. Then many will be offended and will betray one another and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. In other words, many religions will come forth. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will what? They will grow cold. Is that happening? Yes. But he who endures to the end will be what? Saved. And this gospel, the kingdom, will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. In other words, what this is about is Jesus was given a summary. Does everybody get it? Like a summary. Then he goes into detail in the book of Revelations, and then a conclusion. But this is just a summary. Now, I want to go to verse 32. And let's speak it. He says, now, learn this parable from the fig tree. The fig tree represents Israel. When its branches have already become tender and puts forth leaves, you know that summer is near. So you also, when you see all these things, know that it is near and at the doors. Assuredly, I say to you, this what? Generation will by no means pass away till all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the what? As the what? Days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For in all, as in those days before the flood, they were what? Eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until that day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Now, this is so powerful. There's a couple things I want to share with you before we get going. Even the book of Daniel prophesies about all of these events that are getting ready to happen. Again, we have already been in the beginning of sorrows. The beginning of sorrows is almost completed, where tribulation will start at any moment. There are certain things that we're waiting for. There's a 7-year treaty that should be prepared and all kinds of things. But again, he says two powerful things. He says, first of all, Israel must become a nation. Amen? Does everybody understand it? Israel must become a nation, and in that generation is when he is going to return. Things are going to happen. Now he's going to return again. First, he will return through the body of Christ by pouring out his Spirit in a mighty way. Before he physically, personally comes, then he's going to return, but he's not going to touch the earth. He's going to remove the body of Christ and then fulfill the Feast of Trumpets, and then he will return fulfilling the Feast of Atonement. And that's when he will return, and we will return with him. So the first thing that has to happen is Israel must become a nation. And that happened in 1948. Is everybody with me? You're going to need to write some of this stuff down. So in 1948, Israel becomes a nation, right? A generation is 70 years. So 1948 and 70 equals 2018. Is everybody with me? Because it's 70 years as a generation. Now, I want you to grab hold of something, because the Jewish calendar is different. Amen? So in the Jewish calendar, their new year starts on what we call the Feast of Trumpets. That's when the new year starts. It's September, October. So we are already in 2017, aren't we? But in reality, 2017 is going to be a mix between 2017 and 2018, according to the Jewish calendar. So September will start the new year. Does everybody understand it in the Jewish calendar? All right. So we see that the Feast of Trumpets is going to start the new year. Then, right after the Feast of Trumpets, we'll have the Feast of Atonement. Now, these are the two feasts that still must be fulfilled. Jesus fulfilled the first four feasts, and the next feast is called the Feast of Trumpets, which must be fulfilled. Again, there's no coincidence that we have a president called Trump. Amen. Okay, is everybody with me? Now, In the Jewish calendar, this is going to represent a number. It will represent 5777, which is their year. The number 5, so it'll be 5,777. That is the Jewish calendar number. Is everybody with me? Now, that number represents 6,000 years. 5777, which is associated with 2017. So we have entering the 6,000th year. Is everybody with me? Okay. Now, the number 5 means grace, and number 7 means complete and perfect. The number 5 means grace, and the number 7 means complete and perfect. So you got 5777, 3 7s. That is as complete as you can get it. Seven, seven, sevens means complete of age of grace. So we see that there's going to be coming a completion. Now, I want you to understand that we may be off slightly. Amen. So I can't give absolutes, but I can sure give you an area of roundabout. Amen. Does everybody understand that? So we have entered actually what we call the year of Jubilee. And I'm going to talk more about that. But first, I want to confirm a couple things. So we know that it's going to be associated with the times of Noah. Amen. Amen. And we know that Israel must become a nation. And in that generation. Is everybody with me? Now, in the times of Noah, we know that there was Nephilims and giants and much. In fact, there was violence all over the earth, wasn't there? Amen. And there's tremendous violence all over the earth right now, isn't there? So we see that we are actually in the times of Noah. Now, if you'll go with me to Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6. In verse 1, first 3 verses. It says, now it came to pass when men began to what? Multiply in the face of the earth, and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God, which are angels, saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. In other words, these fallen angels put on flesh and took wives and produced offsprings, amen, which were called Nephilims. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh. Yet his day shall be what? 120 years. There were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men who were of old, men of what? Renown. Okay, now go to verse 13. And God said to what? Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me. Hello, that's another prophetic thing, isn't it? This is the time of Noah when he says what? The end of all flesh is coming. The end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with what? Violence through them. And behold, I will what? Destroy them with the earth. Make yourself a what? An ark of gopher wood, make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and outside with pitch. In other words, make something for a way what? Of escape. I want you to look at this prophetically and what's going on. That's why Jesus said this powerfully. He said, it'll be as in the days of Noah. Number one, it's going to be violence all over. Most people don't understand that there's Nephilims here now. We're not going to get into that. In fact, there are children all over the place. They're called demons. Number two, it's going to associate with 120 years, which I'll talk about in a little bit, because it's not associated with, remember he said, a man will live now 120 years. But man was living longer in those days as 120 years, weren't they? So it's a prophetic, and I'm going to explain to you what that is in a few. And then the other thing is that he says that that's going to become the end of all flesh. So this is the time in the days of Noah. Does everybody understand? Okay. And the other thing is what? That there's going to be an escape. The righteous will escape. Does everybody get it? The righteous will escape. Only those that are right with God will escape. Is everybody cool? Yeah. Hallelujah. It's called the Exodus. Amen? So let's go to Exodus 20 for a minute. Exodus 20. I want to lay a foundation before we go to this, so we get an understanding of where we are. So, isn't it pretty remarkable that we are the generation of the Lord's return and all kinds of stuff's getting ready to happen? That's why you see it happening right now. Exodus 20. Hallelujah. All right, and verse 8. It says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you nor your sons, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servants, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath and what? Hallowed it. He sanctified it. Now, I want you to understand that Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. Amen? So for me and you, the word Sabbath means rest. So for every day, your relationship with the Lord, you are practicing the Sabbath every single day in relationship with Him. But He is speaking prophetically now. He's speaking about a time sequence. Why? Because He's talking about 6 days. 6 days. In 6 days. Now I want to explain something about 6 days. The Lord of He did creation, because He's the Lord of the Creator and the Restorer. Amen. He restored and He created in 6 days. And then He blessed the seventh day. Is everybody with me? So we know that there's a time sequence and what it actually means. Now go to 2 Peter 3. Second Peter chapter 3 and verse 5. Second Peter chapter 3 and verse 5. Somebody there? Let's speak it. For this they willfully forget by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of water and in the water, by which the world that existed perished, being flooded with water. But the heavens and the earth, which are now preserved by the same word, are reserved for fire until the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But, beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is what? One day. This is a prophetic number. So what the Lord is saying here, He said 6 days. In other words, God created the earth and restored it in 6 days with representation, and then the Sabbath in the seventh day. In other words, 6,000 years. One day equals a what? 1,000 years. So we know that we are entering the 6,000 year where we know that it's going to become a Sabbath or rest for 1,000-year millennium to come. Is everybody okay? Hallelujah. And in this, it is prophetic so that It is a prophetic timetable. In other words, the Feast of Trumpets, what follows the Feast of Trumpets is the Feast of Atonement, representation, repentance. Repentance. So the grace is going to come in repentance. The grace will come to an end in repentance. Is everybody okay? And in Matthew 17. So one day with the Lord equals 1,000 years. Matthew 17. In verse 1. Now remember, this is prophetic. Would you read it with me? Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And he was what? Transfigured before them. Does everybody understand this? So after 6,000 years, there's a transfiguration coming. Does everybody get it? He was transfigured before them. His face shone like the what? Sun, and his clothes became as white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with them. Now, Moses represents those who have died in Christ. Elijah represents those who are alive when Christ returns. Is everybody cool? All right. Why? Because Moses was buried and then taken. Elijah was taken alive, wasn't he? Amen. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. In other words, this whole event is a representation, is a removal, fulfillment of the Feast of Trumpets, and known as the rapture. After what? 6,000 years. And behold, Jesus from the dead. He's been with them. He says, okay, I've been with you now. I've been with you 40 days. I rose from the dead. On the 50th day, I'm going to send my spirit to you. I'm going to send my spirit in you. Does everybody get it? So Pentecost, 50 days after Jesus rose from the dead, he sent his spirit to liberate his followers, just like Jubilee liberates. So when you are baptized and filled with the Holy Spirit, what's you get liberated, freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's what? Freedom, freedom from bondage, freedom from fear, freedom. And a personal relationship in Christ, where his Spirit now, remember he said, I'll give you a new spirit, a new heart, and I'll put my Spirit in you to cause you to keep my judgments so that you would have power. So understand that these Jubilees are associated with liberty, freedom, restoration. Amen? All right. Now, I'm going to go over a couple things. Just to share quickly, Donald Trump, in other words, there's no coincidence that he is the president. Not only that, it was prophesied in 2007. Here we got the next feast to be fulfilled is trumpets. We have a president that's called Trump. Also, he is 70 years old. And there's no coincidence. Fulfilling the what? Generation. Oh, glory. All right. Now, in 1967, Jerusalem became the capital of Israel. It was a what they call a seven-day war. Does everybody get this? Now, 50 years, a jubilee after Jerusalem becomes the capital of Israel is 2017. Another fulfillment for 2017. Why? Because it's called the year of Jubilee. 2017, 2018. Has everybody got it? So Jerusalem becomes the capital. One jubilee afterwards. What? Liberating freedom. 2017, believe it or not, there's a liberation of freedom that's here and coming and getting greater. It is going, righteousness is going to rule. It is going to be the rule of righteousness. Why? Jesus expressing himself through his body first in greater ways than ever. It's happening. It's beginning to happen more. 2016 is an overlap to 2017, which will overlap 2018. 2016 was known as the year of the sword. 2017 has also been known as the year of explosion or explosive. In other words, many things being unveiled. Many things being unveiled. The year of Jubilee was to bring freedom to the masses and break the bond of oppression. It is a type or forerunner of the future reign of the Messiah, Jesus, setting the stage for the coming king in his reign, offering, and when he comes, he's offering an unending Jubilee. But I want you to know that this is associated, he just like when he poured out his spirit, on the 50th day, we are in a year where he's pouring out, he's expressing himself in a greater, greater way. And eventually, righteousness is going to rule. Righteousness will rule. It may not look like it's ruling, but it's ruling. Does everybody understand that? Until we are removed. Righteousness will rule until we are removed. Does everybody got this? So you're going to have favor like you never thought before. But you got to be in position. You got to be right standing with God. You can't be touching things that are unclean. You got listen, God's time is God's will. You must be in his will and his timing in everything now. Be strategically positioned or the enemy will wipe out many. Because he knows what's going on. Is everybody with me? Leviticus 16. Leviticus 16. The year of Jubilee 2017 is getting ready to explode. One of the major things of marketplace ministries, wherever you are, is your ministry. Amen. Don't let the enemy move you. Amen. You stay strong. Amen? Amen? You make sure. Very sure. But don't let don't let the enemy interrupt what God's will is either. Leviticus 16:29. Remember, God never interrupts himself. Amen? In verse 29, let's read it together. This shall be a what? Statue forever for you. In the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, you shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether a native of your own country or a stranger who dwells among you. For on that day the priest shall make atonement for you to cleanse you, that you may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. Now, wait a minute. Who's our high priest? Jesus. So, again, this is prophetic. This is old covenant. Right now, you and I are cleansed because of the word, the ministry of the Spirit, which means breath. So when you repent, you are washed. Amen. It is a Sabbath of solemn rest for you, and you shall afflict your souls. It is a statue forever. And the priest who is anointed and consecrated to minister as priest in his father's place shall make atonement and put on linen clothes and the holy garments. Well, look, we're going to get that, aren't we? And the day that we are taken home, we will get a garments. Aren't we called priests? Amen. Then he shall make atonement for the holy sanctuary, and he shall make atonement for the tabernacle of meeting and for the altar, and he shall make atonement for the priests, for all the people of the assembly. This shall be an everlasting statute for you to make atonement for the children of Israel for all their sins once a year. And he did as the Lord commanded Moses. Now, we have a high priest, Jesus. We are called to be priests and kings with new garments of righteousness. Yom Kippur is also known as Feast of Atonement. The Feast of Atonement will follow the Feast of Trumpets. Is everybody with me? Which is directly linked to the year of Jubilee. All of these two feasts are linked to the year of Jubilee. Does everybody get it? Feast of Trumpets and Feast of Atonement is linked to the year of Jubilee. And why? Destroying and evil and so forth. Evil, in other words, in the area carrying, because Jesus is going to come and destroy all evil, right? And then he's going to put away Satan for 1,000 years. So for 1,000 years, sin will no longer be influencing anyone. Now, there will still be the old man that will be influencing many people who don't have a glorified body yet. Who's sin in itself? Amen? Until they die, then they'll have to be resurrected. So we see here that the year of Jubilee, as Jesus returns to destroy evil, and those carrying sin for 1,000 years will be clean. The reign of Jubilee is going to be setting captives free from bondage of influence, death, and sickness for that 1,000 years. Now, how many years is Jubilee? 50. All right, you ready for this? From creation to the Exodus. Is everybody with me? From creation to the Exodus is 50 Jubilees. It's 2,500 years. From creation to the Exodus of the Israelites, I want you to understand that Jubilees and feasts, they're all connected. From creation to the Exodus of the Israelites when they were brought free is 50 Jubilees, 2,500 years. From Exodus, how many years are in a generation? From Exodus to 2017 is 70 Jubilees. Hello? Anybody get this? snap. Seventy jubilees from the Exodus to now. It's 70 jubilees. In other words, 70 years generation, remember, complete, boom. All right. So 50 jubilees plus 70 jubilees equals 120 jubilees. Amen? Now, what did the Lord say about the days of Noah? That they would live how many years? 120. Well, we just reached 120 jubilees. Now, 120 jubilees equals 6,000 years. You need to write this down, man. All right, I'm going to repeat this so you get this. From creation to Exodus is 50 jubilees, 2,500 years. Amen. From Exodus to 2017 is 70 jubilees. That equals 120 jubilees, which equals 6,000 years, which is 5777, according to the Jewish calendar. The days of Noah was, he said, in those days, that generation, the Lord will be known as the days of Noah, is 120. Man will live. In other words, the flesh will exist 120 years. Well, it's actually represent because we know that they lived longer than 120 years. What did he mean then? 120 jubilees. 120 jubilees equals 6,000 years. 5777. Now, after 6 days, there was a transfiguration after 6,000 years. Amen? Noah's warning was about a rebellious world, but righteousness will rule, then be removed. And I heard that from the Lord this morning. We had a discussion about some things. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we'll close here. Year of Jubilee. We're in it, man. Think about all of this stuff. You think there's a coincidence in this? No. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. In verse 1. Is everybody there? Is everybody okay? You just need to stay in position so you don't miss the blessing. Believe me, the enemy is going to come stronger. He's trying to influence in multiple ways. He's going to do everything he can to get you out of position. In verse 1, now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one what? Deceive you by enemies, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. Who is that? Satan. Amen. Who what? Who poses and exalts himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Now remember, this is a summary. He's telling you things. He's sharing things ahead. He's not getting into detail yet, but he does. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things, and now you know what is restraining that he may be revealed in his own time? For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. Again, he who's restraining is the body of Christ here on the earth that is restraining evil. Why? Because from this point on, righteousness will rule, even though wicked will scream like crazy. You're going to see all wickedness, scream like crazy, protest. Let me tell you, the house is divided. The Lord said to me, it will never become unity. He said, righteousness will rule until we're removed. So don't expect the country to become unified. It never will become unified. Wickedness will become more wicked, and righteousness will become more righteous. Righteousness will rule, regardless of what. There'll be wars, there'll be famines, there's going to be all kinds of things, but you and I will stay in position, and righteousness will overcome wickedness. And then once we are removed, because it is only the, why? Because God is going to pour out his spirit even more. Why? To restrain evil. Because the devil knows he's got a short period of time. So he's pouring out his, he's getting, allowing us to become stronger. That's why it's so important that you maintain assembling and staying refreshed and refilled all the time. Because you'll be easily misled. Things will come between you and God that you don't even realize. You'll be chasing money instead of chasing God's presence. You'll be chasing something else instead of chasing God's presence. So again, the body of Christ is here to restrain. Amen? He says, and only he who now restrains will do so until he is what? Taken out of the way. Remember, righteousness will rule, and then we're going to be removed. And then what? The lawless one will what? Be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. In other words, this is what's going to eventually happen. The coming of the lawless one is according to who? The working of who? Is anybody reading this with me? Is the working of what? Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. In other words, they did not love the truth. They did not deny themselves. They did not love the truth. For this reason, God will send them what? Strong delusion that they should believe the lie. Look, you are seeing this right now. These people that are protesting all over are only rebelling against God's will. People are not willing to change or love the truth or seek the truth, and they're going to become more and more deceived unless they repent and turn from their way. We are seeing this now. You've never seen this country in this state. Never. It's never been this divided. We've never seen so much wickedness in government and lying. We've never seen so many things. We've never seen so much perversion. We've never seen this before like it is now. And you will see more, but righteousness will still rule and begin to take dominion and expose more, more, and more until we're removed. In verse 12, that's verse 11. For this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who do not believe the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. In other words, have pleasure in same-sex perversion, lust, adultery, lying, stealing, addiction. All of these things are unrighteousness, is lawlessness. Does everybody get it? And anyone who approves of it will also be condemned the same way. Verse 13. But we are bound to give thanks to God always for you, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through the sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. So do you have a choice? Yeah. You have a choice. Even though you've been predestined, you still have a choice to fulfill that predestined plan for you. That means the price is cooperation. Verse 14, to which he called you by our gospel for the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, brethren, what? Stand fast and hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by word or by our epistle. And then may the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ himself, and our God and Father, who has loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope by grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. Year of Jubilee. We're in it. Get ready. Stay positioned. Stay filled. Stay connected. Don't let the enemy disconnect you. Remember, righteous will rule until we're removed. This is it. Isn't this awesome, though? Think about it. Now, like I said, there's no coincidence. Only God knows the exact day and time. Amen. But he sure gives us the Holy Spirit to tell us things to come, doesn't he? Yeah. Yeah. Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Thank you so much for allowing us to know so that we may stand strong and firm and not be swayed by any worldly influence and demonic influence. So that we maintain connection with you, Lord, in every area. Lord, bring to remembrance that what you've spoken to us so that we be continually encouraged. We ask that you continue to establish our thoughts and our steps. Visit us in dreams and visions and revelations. And let your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, in us and through us. For your glory, as you prepare us for your return. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Amen. Be blessed and stay dressed with the glory.